as always, it is a great day to come and study the infallible, inerrant, true Word of God with you. What a privilege we have always to gather and study. Open your Bibles to 1 John, John's first letter, John, 1 John chapter 2, and I'm going to read our section. We've just been continuing along. If you're new with us, we just walk through books together verse by verse, and we've made our way to 1 John chapter 2. We're going to study verses 7 to 11, or at least start studying those verses today. 1 John chapter 2, beginning in verse 7. Let me read those to you aloud and follow along with me, and we'll get started. 1 John chapter 2, verse 7. Beloved, I am writing you no new commandment, but an old commandment that you had heard from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which you have heard. At the same time, it is a new commandment that I'm writing you, which is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. Whoever says he is in the light and hates his brother is still in darkness. Whoever loves his brother abides in the light, and in him there is no cause for stumbling. But whoever hates his brother is in darkness and walks in the darkness and does not know where he is going, because the darkness has blinded his eyes. I pray the Lord blesses even the reading of the word this morning. If you can remember back to the beginning of the year when we launched our study of 1 John, we noted that among several reasons, several purposes that John wrote this book is to reignite a love in their hearts of one another. He wanted them to remember the love to which they were called. They were called to a specific kind of vigorous love, one for another, and this is something that he wanted to revitalize in their life. Over in chapter 3, he talks about the magnificent love that God has for us, and motivated and energized by that love, we should love one another. Verse 11 of chapter 3 says this, "For this is the message that you have heard from the beginning, that we should love one another." John takes it a step further. This is not just some advice. This is not just something he throws out there as sort of a tip for living. No, it's more than that. He says in chapter 4, "Whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love." Again, this reflects the fact that if you are in God and God is in you, you will have God's love. You will be like him. It will be obvious in what you do and how you talk and how you live. So this is another test of your salvation. We saw the moral test last time, and the time before we looked in those sections about obeying the Word of God. That's really the test. Do you obey? Do you love and obey the Word of God? Do you obey His commandments? That's the moral or ethical test. Another test, really a derivative test from that moral test, is this test, the social or relational test. Do you genuinely love your brothers? Do you genuinely love others? Now, before John gets to the actual test is in verses 9, 10, and 11. But before he gets there, he has this whole new old commandment discussion. Verse 7, he says the command to love is an old commandment. Verse 8, he says the command to love is a new commandment. And so what we want to do this morning is sort of unpack those two verses. What does he mean by these two things? It's an old commandment, and it's at the same time, it is a new commandment. And what bearing does it have on us, particularly when we get down in 9, 10, 11 and start to take the test and think about the test of love there in those verses? But before we do that, I need to set the stage. I need to set the stage for what was happening there in that early church. One of the reasons that John is doing all this is because there had been some trouble in the church. I know those of us here in Makakilo, trouble and church, that's an oxymoron. We've never known of such things. These things don't happen to us. It's tongue-in-cheek, right? But there had been some trouble. Although there had been some trouble, I think worse than what most of us have experienced. A whole bunch of people had gotten up and left the church. I don't know if they did it en masse and just sort of stood up one day and walked out. I did pastor a church one time, and the pastor had gotten mad at a number of members, and a previous pastor had gotten mad at a number of members, and he got them all motivated to one Sunday to all stand up with him and walk out the back door. And literally, they sat on one side of the sanctuary, and the other group sat on the other side, and he gave them the cue, and they all stood up, got out their keys and their purses and bags and Bibles, and walked out the back door and went out and started another Baptist church in the community. They all stood up and walked. That must be troubling, right? And I think it was troubling for the people here. I think this kind of hurt. They probably looked around. We're kind of empty today. I don't know why this section's all empty. But imagine if we knew that this empty section over here was a bunch of people who got mad. I got one over here too. Good grief. Imagine if just last week this was full of people and we knew that there was trouble and they all got up and left. And imagine if these are people you knew and you loved and you cared for and you didn't really know why they left, and it seemed like they were good people and kind people and they were very spiritual people. So John is addressing this, and later on he talks about they went out from us. So he's obviously addressing this group that went out from them, that left them. Now, who was this group that left? And ultimately, why did they leave? John talks about this, and we can sort of deduce from what John says why these people left. What was going on sort of under the surface? What did the pastor know? Maybe not that everybody knew, but what did the pastor know, Pastor John, what did he know that maybe others didn't know about these people and why they left? Here's the reason that they ultimately left. This group of people. Ultimately, these people were hypocrites. They were able to produce a surface level Christianity that was not genuine. There was a false level of Christianity. They were able to produce, for instance, a surface level theology. I mean, they could affirm things that everybody who was Christian could affirm, and they talked about these things. In fact, these people, we find out later, these people, sort of the pre-Gnostic folks, these people produced a level of spirituality, and in fact, a level of knowledge that maybe not a lot of people had. And they even intimidated people with their level of knowledge, and people kind of looked at them like, well, these people are spiritual giants. They're very spiritually sensitive. They know a lot about the Bible. They know a lot about these things, and they sort of esteem them. But John says these people, if you start to dig and ask them questions about what they really believe, what you're going to find is they deny very important things such as the deity and humanity of Christ. These are basic beliefs, and these people rejected these things. Even though they claimed to be in the know, even though they looked very spiritual on the surface, they in fact were not true believers at all. They also lacked holiness. No, not on the surface. In fact, again, they looked very holy on the surface. They looked very spiritual on the surface. They looked very good. They could produce all the things. I'm sure they had gone through all the rituals in the church. They had been baptized. They took the Lord's Supper. They looked very good. They did all the good things. There were smiles on Sunday morning, and they shook people's hand, and they volunteered. They did all the good stuff. But again, John says, you begin to dig, and you find out these people do not love the Word of God. They do not love to do it. In fact, that's what we looked at last time. At that first part of chapter 2, we find out that though they could produce sort of a surface level of good deeds, they really did not have a passion to keep and to follow the Word of God. Now, this pattern is true in all areas, in doctrine, as I mentioned, in morality, as mentioned, in their beliefs, in their behavior, and it was also true for their love, which is what we're going to look at today. Their love was only surface. They could produce a level of tolerance, a smile, a happy face. They could greet people. They could be sentimental. They had friends. They were close with people. But as John in this letter gets more and more descriptive about true Christian agape, these people don't pass the test. It's clear that they were hypocrites in this area as well. And so John began to preach, and their character began to be revealed. That antagonism began to wear on them, and him on them, and they on him, and they eventually left. And so John mentions them later there in the chapter there. They went out from us, but were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would have continued with us, but they went out that it might become plain that they all are not of us. Now, I bring this up not because I think this is true of anyone who leaves a church. I think there are many legitimate reasons. I can't think of anybody who's left under the circumstances like this. In fact, there's people who've left our church, usually the legitimate reasons, getting PCS somewhere, right? Or job change, or hours change, or whatever, and things happen, maybe even philosophical difference, and they go, but it's not because of the same reason that John is saying. But the reason I bring this up is that so you can understand why John would want to start bringing up true Christianity at this point. Because a whole bunch of false Christians had left who looked really genuine. And John began to encourage them by saying, look at your own heart, look at your own beliefs, look at your own behavior, look at your own love to test. You test them, and you find out they fall short. You test yourself, this should be of great assurance to you. So this is what John is doing. He's wanting us to take these series of tests, and he goes through these different things. Again, we saw the ethical test, the moral test, and now is the relational or test of love. And even though there was a gap in the group, there was people missing, faces missing that had been around for a long time, John wants them to be assured that the reason they're missing is not because they were such great people, but because in the end they rejected true Christianity. So this is a good opportunity for John to call them to not only think about their own faith, but to inspect what is the nature of saving faith after all? What do genuine Christians believe and live like? How do they love one another? What's their relationships? So this comes to us, in a sense, as a test as well. A series of tests, really, of our own faith. We want to test our own faith from time to time. We want to prove whether or not we are genuine. In passing the test, we find great assurance of our salvation. So this is the relational test, the social test, or you might even want to title it the love test. It is a test of the genuineness of your love. Now, just a quick word here. John doesn't apply this test in full. You know, Paul would get a hold of a doctrine, and he would argue it out, sometimes over the span of several chapters, many, many words and headings and subheadings and sub-subheadings and sub-sub-subheadings and all this to prove his point. He was like a lawyer. He would argue it out. John does it a little differently. He touches on it, and then he moves on, and then he touches on it again, and then he moves on, and he comes back. So we're going to see this about love. He touches on it here. We're going to look at it today and next week, and then we'll move on. And then a few more weeks, we'll be talking about love again. He touches on it, maybe a little bit different angle, a different aspect. He touches on it again. He applies this test of love again. And then he moves on again, and then he touches on it again. I read to you earlier from chapter 3 and chapter 4, again, applying to us this test of love. Well, that's what this section's all about. It's the test of love. But like I said, before he gets to the test, he says a couple things about this commandment to love. It is an old commandment, and it is a new commandment. If you're taking notes, maybe you want to write this down. Number one, the foundation of love. This is essentially what he's getting at when he says the old commandment. This is an old commandment. Look at verse 7 there, beloved. I'm writing you no new commandment, but an old commandment that you had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word that you have heard. Now, we're not told right there in that verse that he's talking about the command to love, but we find this out later on, verse 10, who loves his brother abides in the light. We get a hint of it there in verse 7. He says, beloved, right? That's a derivative or a connecting word, agapatoi. Beloved, my friends, my dear, close, intimate, Christian friends, my beloved. But we also know because John, it wasn't very long since John had written his gospel, and there in his gospel, he had written of several commandments that Jesus said. Jesus said this, a commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, also love one another. He says, this is my commandment, that you love one another. Again, later he says, these things I command you, that you would love one another. So we're not surprised when we get here to 1 John chapter 2, verses 9 to 11, that the commandment is all about love. This is a commandment about love. The issue is love. Well, what does he mean by the command to love is an old commandment? It's not new, it's old. I'm writing to you no new commandment, but an old commandment you've had from the beginning. The old commandment, he calls it again. What does he mean, old commandment? Why would he say old commandment? For one, I think it's possible that John was defending himself against some of these critics who had left the church. Essentially, what you can almost hear them saying as you read the pages of this letter, Essentially, what you hear them saying is something like this: John, you're making Christianity too stringent. You're introducing a new level of perfection and holiness and rules that are legalistic, John. This is a novelty. This is new. I mean, isn't God just welcome everybody? I mean, John, you're being very specific about what we have to believe and how we have to behave. John, you're being very specific about this stuff. Why are you inventing all this new stuff? And John is saying, I'm not giving you anything new. I'm just repeating what's been said. This ethic to love one another, this moral to love, is nothing new. Love one another? You think that's a new thing? A new commandment? No, this is an old commandment. Now, you can hear in that kind of accusation, that has an appeal, that kind of accusation. Why do you have to make Christianity so narrow? Why do you say you have to believe certain things and live a certain way and love a certain way? That has an appeal. I think it has an appeal even in our society today, don't you think? I was watching a television program this week, and I don't even remember what the issue was, but the news presenter came on and said, read a quote from a popular evangelical, Bible-believing Christian leader. I don't know if he's the head of a denomination or something like that, and he read this quote, and it was just a very short quote, and he also mentioned a Bible verse and read the Bible verse. And it was in reaction to some kind of moral question that's, you know, in our society about bathrooms or something like that. And this, you know, this, he read this, right? And then he said, well, I brought on for reaction to this comment. I brought on, and he mentioned this Muslim imam, and he brought on a more liberal Christian from a mainline denomination, the head of some mainline denominational leader, mainline being more progressive, liberal type theology. So he looked at the imam and he said, now what is, you know, as a someone from a different religion, what do you feel about that? And he said, well, you know, we cherish morality. We think morality is good. We think Jesus was a moral person, and we affirm morality and the truths that perhaps, you know, he just kind of said, yeah, we can affirm some level of morality. The Christian, quote unquote, was incensed. He said, I want you to know that guy doesn't represent Christians. He represents a narrow, fundamentalist, legalistic, small group of Christians who believe there's only one way to God and one way to heaven. He's narrow. He's narrow-minded. He was mad. This guy, his veins were popping in his head and neck, and he was just angry that someone might even say that the Bible demands things of us, or the Bible might say there's one way to heaven. You see how this has an appeal? This kind of thing would have been leveled against John. John, you're a legalist. John, why can't we all just get along? Why do we have to have the bar so high as far as what we believe and what we profess and how we act? Why does it have to be so high? Why can't we just lower that and just be accepting of everything? The liberal commentator at one point brought up Mary Magdalene. He said, here's this lady who was probably a prostitute, and Jesus welcomed her. Of course, he forgot to mention that she repented of her prostitution. But it was very clear to point out, hey, why can't we just be open? And this is the kind of thing that would have been John would have been accused of. John, you're adding to the Bible. You're making this too stringent. Why are you being so narrow? You're introducing something new to Scripture. And John says, no, I'm not. This is what's demanded of us. This commandment is an old commandment. This is something that is in every page of Scripture. It bleeds this idea of love, that we should love one another. This is not a new commandment. This is an old commandment. Now, I think for one thing, John is pointing out the oldness of this commandment to defy his critics, that this is something new or legalistic that's not biblical. I think there's another reason that John introduces this idea that this is not a new command, but an old command. That is, this command to love one another flows from the very heart of God. It is as old as the old covenant. It's even older than that. It's as old as God is old. Because God is love, God emanates this idea of love, loving one another. I mentioned the covenant last week, the old covenant, the document, the Decalogue, the Ten Commandments, that God made this special agreement with the people of Israel. And though we are not under that old covenant, we can learn some things about the morality of God. In fact, when you look at the Old Covenant and those Ten Commandments, One thing you learn is that we ought to love one another. Six of the Ten Commands are about loving one another. Did you know that? The first four, by the way, are about loving God. The bottom six are about loving one another. He said to children, honor your father and mother. A child who loves his parents will not dishonor his parents. A child who loves his parents will understand their authority in their life, and they will obey their parents. He said, don't kill. If you love someone, you're not going to kill them, right? Please shake your head, yes. If you love someone, if you love their family, you're not going to kill them. You're not going to murder someone, even in your mind. You're not want them out of your way so you can live your life the way you want. You're not going to live that way. He said, don't commit adultery. If you love someone, you're not going to defile them. Draw them out of their marriage or their future marriage and defile their spouse and their lives. You're not going to commit sin against their spouse because you love their spouse as well. It's an act of love to not commit adultery. Do not steal. You don't steal from those whom you love. Don't lie about. You don't cast aspersion on them. You don't gossip about them. You don't slander them. You don't slander their character. Don't covet. You don't covet what they have. You're glad that they have what they have. You don't want it for yourself. You're glad that they are enjoying those blessings. So all these things are an expression of love, and it goes all the way back, really ultimately, to the heart of God. Again, this is not new. This is not a novelty. This is something that is true with God and has been emanating from God from the beginning of time, the idea of love, the idea of loving one another, and ultimately loving God. If you love him, you will obey him. If you honor him, you respect him, you will love him, you will love others. Of course, we know this is true because when they came to Jesus and they asked, Jesus, what is the greatest commandment? He said out of Deuteronomy chapter 6, the Shema, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. And the second is like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. And that's precisely what we see as we look at all the laws that govern the people of Israel. Again, these are laws that we are not under in a legal way, but we certainly are under the demand of morality. These are laws that display in that community, whether it's sacrifices to love God or whether it's what to do when someone dies or is accidentally killed or when someone is killed purposefully, there's a way they're supposed to operate, and it's all so they can love God and love one another. It can all be boiled down to that one simple command, love. Love God, love one another. So this is not a new idea. So I think John has that in his mind as well. This is not something novel that we should love. This is not something new that we should love. This is as old as God himself. We have a demand on our lives that we should love one another is, in fact, not something new. There's one more aspect, I think, why John brought this idea up, that this is not new, but it is old. It's old in the sense that it was taught to them from the beginning of their faith. Did you see what it said? An old commandment that you had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word that you have heard. So this is something that they heard from the beginning. These people heard this message that they should love one another from the beginning of their what? Salvation. They're in Ephesus. This is probably primarily a Gentile group, though there were some Jews involved. Many of them, perhaps most of them, had not heard, at least from God, that they should love one another, at least from the true God, that they should love one another. But from the very beginning of their salvation, they began to hear and see and understand this idea of genuine, agape, true love for God and for one another. They heard this early. They heard this often, to love one another, to prefer one another, to do only to others as you would have them do to you. And see, the truth is, when you are saved, your relationships are to be revolutionized with this agape love, this true love. There's a redeeming, sanctifying effect because now your love is renewed or made new. And John's saying, look back to the beginning of your salvation. You learned this. This is not just old historically or old in the mind of God or old in the commands of God. This is old for you from the very beginning of your salvation. This is something that you were taught, something that you understood. Those of you who have this amazing new understanding of love, repentance, forgiveness, reconciliation are revolutionized by this idea of love. Think about it for a moment. For one thing, they understood that they do not deserve the grace of God. They're undeserving people. Think how this will revolutionize your own relationships. As a Christian, I'm going to make it very clear. As a Christian, we never have a right, ever, ever, to be insulted. Why is that? Because an insult says, I deserve better. I deserve better treatment. I deserve better positioning. I deserve better this, better that. You're insulted because you feel like you deserve something better. When you become a Christian, you realize what you really deserve, right? I deserve nothing but hell and brimstone and weeping and gnashing of teeth for my eternity. That's what I really deserve. And imagine if you just seasoned all your relationships by taking away any idea of ever being insulted by anyone. Can you imagine how that would help you? Your relationship would be overhauled. You think about it, your relationship with those who are lost, but think about how much better it would be your relationship with other saved people, two saved people who have this understanding. Two saved people understand this, and you multiply those two saved people by dozens and dozens and dozens of more people who come and gather together. They have this new revolutionary understanding of they don't deserve anything. God gave us His grace freely. And that brings me to another idea that maybe you might want to think about when you think about how you learned the love of God from the moment of your salvation, just like these people are encouraged. They were given this grace freely, even as enemies of God. God reaches down and gives us His love and gives us His grace, not by our merit, not because we earned it, not because we demanded it, not because we sort of backed Him into a corner by doing the right things and going through some kind of religious process. No, He gave it to us freely. In the same way, we give our love freely with no conditions to others. No need of recognition, no need of vengeance or getting your right repaid, no pride, no selfishness. You give your love freely. Christians learn from an early point that they also should not seek their own rights and privileges. You're not demanding, you're not making conditions. No, you're always seeking unconditional fellowship, genuine fellowship, a life of reconciliation. True Christians do all that they must do to walk peaceably. We heard this earlier out of Romans, to do all you can do to walk peaceably with others. You're willing to make no amount of sacrifice to ensure this. When there's a broken relationship due to sin, we already have a template. If you've been saved, you have a template of what to do when there's sin, right? There's articulation and confession of sin and repentance of sin, and there's forgiveness and there's reconciliation. There's this whole process. Jesus lays it out in Matthew 18. There's this whole process of how this ought to happen when there's a broken relationship. You walk through this process, and there's repentance and reconciliation and forgiveness. Of all people in the world, we Christians should understand what it is to love one another. All these things is exactly what John is meaning. The command to love another is not some novelty. It's not something that's new to them. He's not saying, by the way, I want to introduce you to a new subject. Maybe you've never heard of it. I'm sure you're not familiar with this. No, he knew they should be familiar with it because they are saved. They know this idea of unconditional love. This is an old commandment in the sense not only that it's historic and foundational theologically, but it's foundational for them personally on a spiritual level. So this is an old commandment. That's number one. Number two, the picture and presence of love. The picture and presence of love. This is what he means by a new commandment. We have a new picture and a new presence of love, and we see this there in verse 8. Look what it says. At the same time, it is a new commandment that I'm writing to you, which is true in Him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. Now, John says this commandment, and I like the way the ESV says it, at the same time. While it's still an old commandment, John is not contradicting himself. It's an old commandment, yes, but at the same time, it's also a new commandment. I like the word new there, kainos. It means not so much chronologically new or new in the sense that it's never been heard of, but there's a new quality. There's a new reality. It's the old, old story, the old commandment, but it's come in a new sense. Well, how is this new? I point you to these two words. It's the picture and the presence of love. What's the picture of love? Look at verse 8. At the same time, it is a new commandment that I'm writing to you, which is true in Him. Stop right there. What's the newness? The newness is the picture of Christ. Never before had the earth seen anybody love perfectly. And not many years before these people walked the earth, there was someone who walked the earth, the Son of God, and He loved perfectly. And the Gospels were written, and we hear of them. And the people in this, at the time of John wrote this, the Gospels were all written, all completed. They were familiar with the story of Jesus Christ. They understood the way in which Jesus walked. This new commandment is new because they saw it for the first time. They saw it in high definition, living color. They read about the life of Christ. They heard testimony of the life of Christ. So in that sense, this is a new commandment because we saw it for the first time. If you did your homework, you heard or read a sermon there. The preacher gave the beautiful selfless love of Christ illustrated in the upper room not long before He would be crucified. There they are, all the disciples all gathered up there in the upper room, and they're embroiled in an argument of who would be greatest. Who is going to be Jesus' VP, in essence, right? Who's going to be the guy who carries out the orders? Who's going to be the guy that's sitting at the right hand of Jesus? You know, we know Jesus is sort of on charge, but who's going to be right there? Is it going to be Peter, John, James? Who's it going to be? And they were embroiled in this argument. I know it sounds silly and childish, but just take a look at some of your own arguments. They'll sound silly and childish as well, so we can't blame the disciples very much. Here they are, arguing about who will be greatest. Who's going to be the highest? Who's going to be on top? Who's going to be the one who takes sort of the primary position as far as apostles go? And this is just hours before He's going to be arrested, flogged, and put on a cross. All of this is about to happen to Him, not for His own sin, but for our sin. And they're up there arguing about who would be greatest. At the same time, Judas is in the room, and he's over there daydreaming in the corner of how he's going to spend his 30 pieces of silver, right? He's getting ready to get his money. He's getting ready to get his cash. By the way, one time I looked up how much 30 pieces of silver is worth in the modern day. And I thought this is going to make him rich, and this is why he wanted this so much. But I found out 30 pieces of silver on the high end, the highest estimation that I could find, scholars say it's worth about $600. And most of them say it's more like around $250. No wonder Judas went and hung himself. That was the price of his soul, $250 lousy bucks. A PlayStation. It's all he could buy. A PlayStation is this, older people, this is this device that children play games on. That was the price of his soul. And he's up there daydreaming how he's going to get his $250. And what does Jesus do? Jesus walks in the room and very quietly walks over. He takes off his jacket, his outer cloak, puts on an apron, and begins to wash the feet of the disciples. This is the Lord of the universe, the Son of God, loving and serving His disciples. No one had seen love like this. No one understood this kind of love. They were amazed at the love of Christ. And you just look at the life of Christ. This is demonstrated all throughout His life. Several times it says that Jesus, when he saw the crowds, He was moved with compassion. He knew those crowds would primarily reject Him. He knew their love for Him was shallow and false. And some of them would actually be standing in the crowd one day yelling, "Crucify Him!" He knew that. And yet He loved them. He was moved for compassion because of them, a sheep without a shepherd. We see Jesus' love for His people, the Jews. He talks about when He went up on the hill right before he entered into Jerusalem, and he says, "Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how I would gather you under my wings. I would bring you close under my wings, like a hen with her brood, but you resisted." He shows his love for the Gentiles when he healed one after the other, after the other, after the other, sometimes to the exclusion of even healing his own people. He shows his love for the elite, the self-righteous. He reaches out to Matthew, Zacchaeus, the centurion, Nicodemus. He shows his love for the down and outers by healing them and blessing countless impoverished people, countless sick, lame, outcasts, people like Mary, Bartimaeus, Lazarus. He shows his love for children. He shows his love for the elder, for men, for women, for slaves, for free, for kinsmen, those completely different, ethnically speaking. No one had done this before. No one had demonstrated this kind of love before. Never in history had people seen this kind of love before. And of course, the real picture of his love came in a sacrifice, based first of all in his love for God, right? Jesus ultimately died for God. Jesus ultimately died because that's what God wanted him to do, and he wanted to love God and honor him and worship him, and he did nothing but that which the Father told him to do. And his love for God, he went to the cross. But it was also because of his love for us, right? He came because of his love for us. And he paid for our sin. He had done nothing wrong, nothing at all. And he paid for our sin. This is what motivated Paul, I think, when he was writing in Ephesians chapter 5, connecting this love of Christ for us to motivate us to love one another. Ephesians chapter 5 says this: "Therefore be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God." So, Christian, we follow this command not only because it's an old command, but because we saw it in the picture newly in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ demonstrated for the first time in history genuine agape love. This agape love is also new in terms of its spiritual presence, its presence in your own lives. Look there at verse 8 again. "At the same time, it's a new commandment that I'm writing to you, which is true in him and in you. Because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining." Did you hear that? That perfect, holy, divine, unconditional agape is in you if you're born again. If you're a genuine believer, that love is in you. Christ, after his ascension, sent the Spirit, and whoever repents and follows Christ is indwelt by the Spirit, and that love abides in you. And you know this is true. You sense it. You're convicted by it. You understand it. You're driven to love, to forgive, to care. There's a tenderness about you. There's a desire to perfect this in your lifetime, to pursue after this love. And though we're still saddled with this flesh and we deal with this unloving flesh, we know that down deep inside, we really do want to love. And the perfect desire is there, emanating directly from the Spirit himself. Paul would say in Ephesians 1, we are blessed with all spiritual blessings from the heavenlies. Why is that? Because we're indwelt by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit has for us that perfect love. It is in us. It may not be flowing through us like it should. It may be altered and changed and maybe ignored sometimes by us. But we want that love by the Spirit to dwell in us richly by the Word of God. And don't you identify with that further description? What does it say? The darkness is passing away, and the true light is already shining. What a wonderful description of what happened to you at salvation, from darkness to light. And not just you went from lost in the dark to absolute perfection. There's a sense in which, yes, you saw the light, and your spirit was redeemed, but this continued work of sanctification where things are getting brighter, or supposedly getting better and brighter, and your love is getting perfected more and more as you live out your life. This idea from moving from darkness to light has all sorts of biblical precedent. In fact, the Reformers adopted this phrase. It was from a phrase in the Latin Vulgate Bible from the book of Job. They adopted this phrase, and it says this, post tenebris lux, after darkness, light. They etched it on the coinage in Geneva. Later, when they set up the Reformers' wall, they engraved it in the stone there. Post tenebris lux. You have gone from spiritual darkness. You have gone from spiritual inability. You have gone from spiritual death to life, to light, to true love. You've gone from superficial fake love, tolerance, all the stuff that the world can produce, to being able finally by the Holy Spirit to produce true, genuine love. You live in the light, as we've seen already in this letter. This theme, darkness, light, is all throughout the Bible. God taking you in salvation from darkness to light. Jesus Christ, by his advent, coming to this world, providing us a way to escape the dungeon. That's the idea. In Isaiah chapter 41, Isaiah was prophesying about the coming Messiah, and he pictures humanity in a dungeon, in a deep, dark, dank, stinky, stingy, nasty, filthy, bleak, black dungeon. And they're down there, and they're just moaning, crying for the day when the Messiah of light would come and pull them out of that darkness into his marvelous light. We hear that theme of Isaiah 42 actually. We hear that theme of Isaiah when Zechariah, remember Zechariah was the father of John the Baptist. Zechariah, his wife miraculously conceived, Mary miraculously conceived. His wife had the baby, and Zechariah, his lips were loosed. Remember, he was mute. His lips were loosed, and he sang a song. And there at the end of the song, he says this, "The sunrise shall visit us from on high to give light to those who sit in darkness." If you're saved, you're familiar with that move from darkness to light, from the dungeon to freedom, from superficial, fake, false tolerance and sentimentality to genuine, real, unconditional agape love. You know that transition. And it was new to you the day you were born again. This should be true of you, that you can then, therefore, display it. You can actually be like Christ for the first time ever. You can actually live like Jesus did for the first time ever. You can actually pass the test of love here, the relational test here. In fact, let's look at that text and we will be finished. Whoever says he's in the light and hates his brother is still in darkness. Whoever loves his brother abides in the light, and in him there is no cause for stumbling. But whoever hates his brother is in the darkness and walks in darkness and does not know where he's going because the darkness has blinded his eyes. He's even clueless to the fact that he's in darkness, stumbling around, thinking he's loving people when in fact he doesn't even understand what the nature of love is. And the great thing is, if you've been born again and you begin to apply the test of love here, you may find great failure in your life. You may find that in taking this test. You may find that you've fallen short. But you may also find simultaneously a great desire to do the right thing, to love in the way in which he loved you. And that ought to bring you some great assurance that you are indeed a child of God.